Hello students, in previous session I introduced unit 9, that is biotechnology, principles and processes. Let us study one by one the main steps involved in genetic engineering, which is also known as recombinant DNA technology, and it is also known as gene cloning technique. Genetic engineering is defined as in vitro transfer of gene of interest or desired gene into the host cell using a vector to obtain the clones of the desired gene or the product of the gene. For this genetic engineering, we need to maintain sterile aseptic condition everywhere. Now, for genetic engineering, there are mainly three tools involved. Number one, enzymes. Number two, cloning vectors. Number three, competent host cell. Please memorize these three tools one by one. First is enzyme, second is cloning vector, and third is competent host cell. Let us now discuss one by one the tools and its uses in the process of genetic engineering. In this session, I'll discuss about the enzymes. There are mainly two enzymes: restriction endonuclease, which is used as molecular scissor or genetic scissor, and the second, ligase, which is known as molecular or genetic stitcher or molecular glue. These two enzymes are used in a technique called gene splicing. Splicing, what you already heard in transcription in eukaryotes, where the introns are cleaved and exons are brought together. In this, hnRNA get transformed into functional messenger RNA. So here, gene of interest we can load on a molecular vehicle called cloning vector. For this, we are using first REN for taking a cleave or restricting the required DNA at a particular site, and after inserting gene of interest, we need to catalyze the formation of bonds between the cut ends so that we will obtain recombinant DNA molecule. Now let us start the enzyme 1, restriction endonuclease. They are found in prokaryotic cells. The specialty of REN is they will recognize palindromic sequences on the DNA. Now, what exactly palindrome is? If you see the nucleotide sequence from 5 prime to 3 prime and 3 prime to 5 prime, the nucleotide arrangement can be read in backward and forward direction, it remains same. It usually contain minimum 4 or maximum 6 base pairs. So restriction endonuclease recognizing such palindromes and using a specific site for its restriction. Restriction is cleaving the DNA molecule at particular targeted site. Now basically, endonucleases are of two types. The enzyme which is cleaving the nucleotides from 5 prime or 3 prime end we call exonucleases. And the enzyme which is used as guided missiles which will restrict the DNA within the molecule, so we call them as restriction endonucleases. In previous paper, two types of endo and exonucleases are expected as answer. This question appeared for 2 marks. First REN was isolated from Haemophilus influenzae, and the name given is HIND3. Sir Hamilton Smith isolated this REN for the first time from Haemophilus influenzae. So remember, there are some principles followed in naming REN. I'll give one by one all examples. HIND2, HIND3, ECOR1, BAMH1, SAL1, CLA1. Now, if you see all these names, first letter, which is capital, is specifying the genus name of the bacterium from which the enzyme is isolated. Next two small letters indicating the species name of that bacterium. And if you find a fourth alphabet, it is specifying the strain of bacterial generation, and the number which is indicated, it is the product number. So first letter is from genus name, next two alphabets from species name. If fourth alphabet is present, it is the strain and the number specifying the product. So HIND2 means the REN isolated from Haemophilus influenzae strain D and product 2. Like that ECOR1, enzyme isolated from Escherichia coli strain R and product 1. Thus, RENs are named according to the organism's genus and species, strain and the product number. Let us revise about REN. These are the enzymes used for cleaving the DNA at a particular site. When we use this enzyme to cleave the nucleotides from 5' to 3' regions, we call it as exonuclease. When the enzyme is used to restrict the DNA within the region, then it is called endonuclease. This enzyme is having ability to recognize palindromic sequences, which are called reverse repeats, and cleave the DNA at particular site. Now, after cleaving, now there are two options. Either the blunt ends are obtained or staggered ends are obtained. Blunt ends are non-reactive and staggered ends are highly reactive. Thus, in genetic engineering, the most specified ends are staggered ends, which can easily join with the inserted DNA or inserted gene. Now, let us go to second enzyme, ligase. Sir Hargovind Khorana isolated ligase from Escherichia coli. You already heard this name in the mechanism of DNA replication, which is semi-conservative type. So in almost all cells, this enzyme is available to catalyze formation of diester bonds and hydrogen bonds among Okazaki fragments to maintain the continuity during semi-conservative replication of DNA. Same enzyme is used in genetic engineering to join the cut ends of the DNA so that we can obtain the recombinant DNA. This is about tool number one. Second tool is cloning vector. Vectors are basically defined as molecular carriers. They are nothing but the DNA isolated from the bacteria, can be stored in vitro condition. They can enter the cell through semi-permeable membranes. They can easily incorporate with alien DNA. They can replicate at the faster rate. Please try to remember all these abilities of cloning vectors. The cloning vectors are usually the plasmid. Plasmids are defined as circular double-stranded self-replicating DNA molecules which are extra chromosomal in appearance. So we can isolate easily, we can store in vitro, we can insert alien gene, we can transfer it into the host cell via semi-permeable membranes. It is replicating at the higher rate. That's why plasmid is the most ideal cloning vector used so far. Based on the abilities of natural plasmid, Bolivar and Rodrigues constructed a synthetic plasmid and it is named as PBR322. The structure of this synthetic plasmid we'll study in the next session. This cloning vector may be plasmid, cosmid or phasmid, or the synthetic plasmids are PBR322 and PUC18. any vector, it should follow or it should have three features. It should contain ORI site. It is origin of replication site, which is stimulated to obtain multiple copies by replication method. Second, they should have cloning sites, which are nothing but the palindromes. Recognized by specific REN, they'll restrict, obtain the staggered end so that we can insert gene of interest into it. And third, they should have selectable marker genes. These are antibiotic resistance genes, which remain active in presence or which will resist the antibiotic which is added to the medium, which are helping in selection of the transformants. So, ideal cloning vector must have three features. Number one, it should have ORI site. Number two, it should have selectable markers. And number three, it should have cloning sites. Tool number three is competent host cell. The most preferred host cell to get the products for human welfare are E. coli, which are easy to culture, they are harmless, so easy to handle, they can survive even in anaerobic condition, and simple lactose medium can be used for their culturing. They can easily respond to the change in the medium, they can easily undergoing transformation, and that's why the most preferred host cell to obtain the products for human welfare is Escherichia coli. But if you want to bring the changes in the plant cell, then the host cell preferred is Agrobacterium tumefaciens. So please try to remember commonly used host cells in genetic engineering, E. coli and Agrobacterium tumefaciens. As the DNA molecule is hydrophilic, it cannot easily pass through semi-permeable membranes. That's why the membranes of the host cells has to be made permeable to receive recombinant DNA. That's why there are several methods adopted to make the host cell competent to receive rDNA molecule. First method is chemical method, where culture of host cell is kept in ice cold medium. Then after adding rDNA, calcium chloride, raising the temperature up to 42 degrees Celsius, we can make the membranes permeable to receive rDNA and again bringing it to the 0 degrees Celsius. Second method is electroporation. In the culture medium, electric field is created using electrodes. The electric pulses will make the cell membrane permeable to receive rDNA. The latest techniques for introducing gene of interest into the plant cells is biolisting, where high velocity gold and tungsten particles coated with rDNA are bombarded on the desired cells. It ensures 100% entry of rDNA along with genes of interest. And for animal cells, a micro syringe is used, which will take rDNA or gene of interest, can be injected directly into the nucleus of the animal cell. This we call micro injections. Children, you need to remember four methods to make the host cell competent. Number one, it is chemical method. Number two, it is electroporation. Number three, biolisting. And number four, micro injection. Thus, in this session, I discussed with you all about the tools used in detail. First, enzyme, REN and ligase, used for gene splicing to obtain rDNA. Second, cloning vector is either plasmid or PBR322 with ORI site, cloning sites and selectable markers. And number three, host cell like E. coli and Agrobacterium tumefaciens, which has to be made competent by various methods. With this, I'll conclude today's session. Thank you very much.